Welcome once again, hello student friends. In this topic, we are going to discuss multi-stage transistor amplifier. In previous, we have seen a single-stage transistor amplifier. You can see the full video of single-stage transistor amplifier. The link is above. In case of a multi-stage transistor amplifier, why we need a multi-stage transistor amplifier? So in case of a single stage transistor amplifier, it is usually insufficient to drive an output devices which requires higher power or higher voltage. In other words, we can say the gain of single stage amplifier is inadequate for practical purposes. So additional amplifications is necessary. We can have 2 to 3 stages of this transistor amplifier by coupling each other. This is the way the resulting system will be referred as multi-stage transistor amplifier. In case of multi-stage transistor amplifier, a number of single amplifiers are connected in cascade arrangement. So what is cascade arrangement? Cascade arrangement is nothing but output of first is connected to the input of the second. Then the input of the second will give us an output. The output of second again connected to the input of third and so on. So it is connected through a suitable coupling devices. So the purpose of the coupling devices is to transfer AC output from one stage to the input of the next stage and also isolate the DC condition from one stage to the next stage. So which coupling devices we are going to use? So we can have a capacitor as a coupling device. We can have a transformer as a coupling device. In some cases, there is no need to have a coupling device. We can couple directly. So we can have a directly coupled transistor amplifier. We can see the first stage, the input is connected to the first stage. Then there is a coupling device that may be, we can say, a direct coupling, capacitor coupling or transformer coupling. The input fed to the second stage. Again, after the second stage, we have a coupling, capacitor, direct or transformer, and then we'll give to the third stage. So finally, we'll have output. So why need all these stages? Because the gain of the first stage is suppose A1, then the gain of the second stage will be A2, and gain of the third stage will be A3. So finally, what we'll have? We'll have these gains, they are multiplied to each other. According to the coupling, the names are also given to the amplifier. So which type of coupling we are using, the name is there. So if we use RC coupling, there will be RC coupled amplifier. If we have a transformer coupling, it is called as transformer coupled amplifier. And for direct coupling, we'll have a direct coupled amplifier. Before proceeding to the multi-stage amplifier, we need to understand some important terms. One of the important terms is called as gain. So as you know, the gain is nothing but output divided by input. So what is output and what is input? So in case of our amplifier, output electrical quantity to the input electrical quantity, that called as gain of the amplifier. So the electrical quantity may be in terms of current, voltage or power, so that we'll have accordingly a current gain, current output divided by current input, voltage output divided by voltage input called as voltage gain, and power output divided by power input is called as a power gain. So I've told you that if we have three stages which have again G1, G2 and G3, so these stages are get multiplied to each other to have gain G, that is called as a overall gain. So the gain of the multi-stage amplifier is equal to the product of the gains of the individual stages, but kept in mind that a note, the total gain G, we can say this G is always less than the product of this. So we can say the product of these will be greater and the overall gain will be less. So why this? Because we are taking it individually, G1 individually taken, G2 individually taken, G3 individually taken. Multiply by that, it will become approximately equal to G. Why it is approximately? It will always less than, because of the concept of loading. So the loading of the next stage is that affect the gain of the first stage. Means the loading at this point G2, that will affect the gain G1. If we have a multi-stage transistor amplifier, the loading at G3, it will affect the gain G2. G3 is the output, the last stage, so there will be no loading at all. So only G1 and G2's loading will reduce the gain, overall gain of the multi-stage transistor amplifier. The second important term is called as a frequency response, one of the most important term in case of a transistor as an amplifier. So as you know, the voltage gain of an amplifier varies with the signal frequency. Obviously, it is because of the reactance of the capacitor. So you can see the reactance of the capacitor is Xc is equal to 1 upon 2 pi Fc. So this is the capacitor, while this is a frequency. So according to the signal frequency, we can have reactance, and that will affect the overall voltage gain. So as frequency increases, we'll get change in reactance, and finally we'll have change in gain. So the curve in between voltage gain and a signal frequency of an amplifier is called as a frequency response. You can see here once waveform, a voltage gain versus frequency. Here you can see the voltage gain is approximately equal to zero for a frequency, which is also approximately equal to zero. If we increase the frequency from this point towards FR, FR is called as a resonant frequency. So resonant frequency at which the voltage gain is maximum, that is called as a resonant frequency. After the resonant frequency, again if we increase the frequency beyond this point, we'll get the gain that is decreasing. So we can see up to this point we are getting the voltage gain, a bigger one, while less than this what we are getting, a lower voltage gains. This is due to again the reactances that we have discussed earlier. The next important part is called a decibel gain. So we can say the gain of an amplifier that is expressed as a number, but in practical importance we have to express that in some sort of unit. So unit of the decibel gain, we can say it is bell or a decibel. So how we are going to define the power gain? So power gain in case of a bell, we can define it as to be log to the base 10 P out upon P. So P out is the output power and P in is the input power. This is the ratio of called as a gain. Why it is called as power gain? Because P out is a power output divided by power input. So if we take to the log to the base 10, we'll get a bell. While if we need a decibel, 1 bell is equal to 10 decibels. Now we need a power gain log to the base 10 P out divided by P in a bell. If we need in a decibel, it will be 10 log to the base 10 P out divided by P in. So if we have to convert the power gain into voltage gain, you should know the formula P is equal to I into V, that is also called as V square upon R. So if we have to put the value of P out, so P out is equal to V out square divided by R. Again P in is equal to v in square upon r. If we put the values of v out square and v in square in here, what it will get? The square goes towards this, so it becomes a 2 multiplied by 10 log to the base 10 v out divided by v. So it will be 20 log to the base 10 v out divided by v in. So this is in decibel. If we need the current gain, again, as you know, P is equal to I square R. So P out is equal to I out square into R. Again, P in is equal to I in square into R. So again, if we solve it, we'll get 20 log to the base 10 I out upon I in. As the square, it is go and multiply with the 10. What we know about the next parameter called a bandwidth. So the range of frequency over which the voltage gain is equal or greater than 70.7% of the maximum gain. So this is known to be as a bandwidth. So why 70.7% of the maximum gain? This is because all of us as a human being, the human hair is not a very sensitive hearing device. So the ear cannot detect the change in intensity of sound in between 100 to 70.7. this is experimentally proof. So that's why the gain beyond 70.7%, it will be like no change to the human ear. So that's why we can say the bandwidth can be considered to be as the voltage gain which is equal to or greater than 70.7% of the maximum gain. If it falls below 70.7%, then ear will hear the distortion. You can see the graph of voltage gain versus frequency. The voltage gain, it is always changes with the frequency, as because of the reactances, capacitive reactances. So it is clear that any frequency lying in between F1 and F2, the gain is equal to 70.7% of the maximum gain. Now we can call it as F1, F2. F2 is the maximum frequency, F1 is the minimum frequency. We can have F1 minus F2 or F2 minus F1 as the bandwidth. So we can call F1 and F2 as the limiting frequencies. So we can say this F1 as the lowest frequency, we can say it as a lower cutoff frequency, and this F2 to be as the upper cutoff frequency. So we can see the bandwidth is nothing but upper cutoff minus lower cutoff. So to have a distortionless amplification, it is important to that the signal frequency must be within the bandwidth. So this is the bandwidth. Signal frequency should be within this limit, then and then only we'll have a proper amplification. We can say distortionless amplification. Bandwidth is also expressed in terms of dB. Suppose the voltage gain of an amplifier is 100, then 70.70% of it is 70.7. So if fall in voltage gain from maximum gain, we can consider to be as 20 log to the base 10 100 minus 20 log to the base 10 70.7. So we can have 20 log to the base 10. So as the logarithm subtraction is there, the 100 will be divided by 70.7. So if we take the ratio of it, it will be 1.4142. So if we take 20 log to the base 10, 1.4142 in decibel, we'll have a 3 dB. So we can say these points has a name because it is a 70.7% onward, that is called as a 3 dB points. So bandwidth of the amplifier is in the range of frequency at the limit which its voltage gain falls by 3 dB. So we can say this is a 3 decibel point from the maximum frequency or maximum gain. So this frequency F1 and this frequency F2, they are also called as a 3 dB frequencies, or we can say half power frequencies. If you have to solve the example regarding the multi-stage transistor amplifier, if we know the voltage gain 100, second stage gain is 200 and the third stage gain is 400, we have to find out the total voltage gain. So theoretically we can find it out as like 40 will be the gain of first, then 46 will be the gain of second, and 52 that will be gain of third. So the total voltage gain will be 40 plus 46 plus 52. So individually what we will have, 138 dB gain. So separately it will be a 138 decibel. If we take it in a 3-stage amplifier in a cascade arrangement, then they will get multiply like G1 multiply by G2 multiply by G3. So in case of multi-stage transistor amplifier, we have RC coupled transistor amplifier, as this is the most popular type of coupling because we are using R and C. So these are the components, they are very cheap, and it also provides the excellent audio fidelity over a wide range of frequency. But it is usually employed for voltage amplification purpose only. So we'll see how RC coupled transistor amplifier is. So this is the figure of a RC coupled transistor amplifier, where, as you know, this is the first stage of the transistor amplifier. So if we you want to know regarding, if you not seen my first video on the first stage transistor amplifier, you can see, the link is above. Now the coupling capacitor CC is used to connect the first stage of this circuit to the next stage of the transistor, that is called as transistor as an amplifier to the next stage. So as the coupling is done from one stage to the next stage, it is followed by a resistance R2. So this R2 is in shunt with this capacitor. That's why it is called as a RC coupling transistor amplifier. The resistance R1, we can say this resistance R1, resistance R2, resistance RE is used for biasing and stabilization. Again, same in the next stage as well, resistance R1, resistance R2 and resistance RE, that is used for the biasing and stabilization. The emitter bypass capacitor, this is the emitter bypass capacitor, that will offers a low reactance path to the signal. So it will offers a low reactance path to the signal. If we not use it, what will happen? As you know, the output becomes less. As we described in a single stage transistor amplifier, the voltage gain of the each stage will be reduced. The coupling capacitor CC that transmit the AC signal that are coming from the first stage, that will go to the next stage. So it will act like the Cin of the first stage. The next stage Cin will be coupling capacitor CC. Now, though we are having only the AC signal over here, still VCC supplying a DC through this RC. So this capacitor again blocks the DC. So it will prevent the DC interference between the various stages, and it will shifting the operating point. So it will be easily reduced of the shifting of the operating point. So as we know, the AC signal is applied to the base of the transistor. So we can say this is a first stage. The AC signal is applied over here. It is available here in amplified format across the collector load RC. The amplified signal that is developed across RC is given to the next stage base through a coupling capacitor CC. So we have a coupling capacitor CC. Again, we have RC in here, the output will be there. Again, a coupling capacitor is there, and we'll have a third stage, and so on. So it will be like this. The cascade arrangement will amplify the signal, and the overall gain is considerably increased. So as we have mentioned that the total gain is always less than the product of the individual stages. Because as we know, when second stage is made to follow the first stage, the effective load resistance of the first stage is reduced due to the shunting effect of the input resistance of the second stage. That is, we have considered it to be as R2. So R2 and CC is in shunt with each other. That's why it is called as RC coupled transistor amplifier. And due to the effect of it, it becomes what we call as a loading effect. So the reduced of the gain stage, which is loaded by the next stage R2 actually. So in case of a three stage amplifier, the gain of the first and second stage will be reduced due to the loading effect of the first next stage. So I have said that this is the first, this is the second, and this is the third, what will happen? The resistor available in here, the R2, it will affect the gain of the first. Resistor available in here, that will affect the gain of the previous stage. So overall gain, we can say the G1 multiply by G2 multiply by G3 is always less. We talk about the frequency response. So here is the frequency response graph of the RC coupled amplifier. So if we do the experiment by building the RC coupled transistor amplifier and fade input frequency to this RC coupled amplifier. So input frequency from zero towards the maximum whatsoever the signal generator or function generator you have. And if we calculate the voltage gain, and then if we plot the graph of voltage gain versus frequency. So you will see that there are three stages where 50 Hertz below, the gain is decreasing as like this. In between them, the gain is considerably constant, and after 20 kilohertz again the gain is decreasing. So what happens when we have a low frequency? So as you know, the coupling capacitor plays very important role. As I've said that XC is equal to 1 upon 2 pi FC. So this F is very very small, but the capacitor that we are using, like in case of this, we are using, if suppose 10 microfarad, then this XC's value, because of this 10 microfarad, 10 raised to minus 6, it will go beyond in the numerator to become 10 raised to plus 6. This XC's value very very high. So if we have a less frequencies, less than 50 Hertz we supposed to be, what will happen? The reactance will be very very high. Then the second method, or we can say the second option, the CE, that cannot shunt the emitter resistance RE effectively because of its large reactance at low frequency. So as we can see, the CE is also the capacitor that is also having a XC is equal to 1 upon 2 pi FC. As frequency is small, XC will be large. So if we have a large reactance at low frequencies, so it will effectively cannot shunt the emitter resistance. So what will happen if it cannot shunt the emitter resistance, what will happen? All the what we call a current that will flow through this RE only, it will not going to flow through this bypass capacitor, and then overall gain will be reduced. So that's why the gain is reduced. In between 20, means if suppose it to be greater than a 20 kilohertz, So we can say the reactance of CC is very small. So you can see here again XC is equal to 1 upon 2 pi FC. So 1 upon 2 pi. So F is supposed to be a 20 kilohertz and the C is supposed to be a 10 into 10 raised to minus 6. So the overall thing, if we calculate it, XC will be, as frequency is increased, XC will be very, very small. So what will happen if XC is very, very small? It will act like a short circuit. So this will increase the loading effect of the next stage and reduce the voltage gain. So again, if the frequency is higher, we are getting the reduced voltage gain due to this coupling capacitor CC. So moreover, at high frequency, the capacitive reactance of the base emitter junction, we have said this is CE, is low, which increases the base current and this reduces the current amplification factor beta. So beta is equal to IC upon IB. If IB get increased, beta will get decreased, and in this way we are getting the reduced voltage gain. So this is the two reasons why the voltage gain drops off at high frequencies. Now in between 15 to 20 kilohertz, what is happening now? So the voltage gain of the amplifier is very much constant. The effect of coupling capacitor in this frequency range is so as to maintain a uniform voltage gain. So it is not affecting the gain of the transistor amplifier. And as frequency increases in this range, the reactance of CC decreases, coupling capacitor decreases, which tends to increase the gain. So in this way, we are getting a constant gain in 20 kilohertz. So at same time, the reactance, lower reactance means higher loading effect of the first stage, and hence it will be lowering the gain. So as we are saying that if suppose the reactance is increasing, so what will happen? It will affect the loading of the next stage. It will lower the gain. So gain should be get like increased in this way, but due to this loading effect, the gain is reduced and it will remain as a constant. So these two factors almost cancels each other and resulting in a uniform gain at mid frequency. So what are the advantages of the RC coupled transistor amplifier? So it has excellent frequency response in between 50 to 20 kilohertz. The gain is constant over the audio frequency range. So 20 to 20 kilohertz is the region of the speech, we can say a talk or a music. So it is very much useful for us to use RC coupled amplifier wherever we are using a speech or a music. According to the components we are using, resistors and capacitor, they are very, very cheap, so the cost will be a lower one. And the next thing is that we can have a very compact circuit, as the resistors nowadays and capacitors nowadays, they are like very, very small, we can say they are extremely light as well. So we can have a very, very compact circuit of the RC coupled transistor amplifier. These having some sort of disadvantages, like this have a very low voltage, we can say a very low power gain. It is because the low resistance presented by the input of each stage to the preceding stage decreases the effectively load resistance RIC, and hence the gain. So we are using the values of the resistances at input side, they are very, very low. So effectively the load resistance will be, we have to kept it low, that's why the gain it becomes low. So if we have to increase the gain, we have to increase the number of stages, and according to the cost point of view, if we increase the number of stages, the space and the cost will be increased. Then they have a tendency to become noisy with the age, as we are using transistors and RC circuits, and if we going to use them in a moist climates, they are going to get noisy again. Impedance matching is poor because the output impedance of the RC coupled amplifier is a several hundreds of ohm, while if we use a speaker, the speaker has a few ohms of the impedance. So impedance matching is not properly happening in this case of RC coupled amplifier. So hence a little power will be transferred to the speaker and the speaker's volume will be very, very low. So we have to go for the next coupling, that is called as a transformer coupled amplifier. So this is best for the impedance matching concept only. So the main reason for low voltage and power gain of RC coupled amplifier is that the effective load resistance of each stage is decreased. So because of this, to avoid the loading effect to the previous stage, we are keeping the same resistance. So that's why we are like decreasing the gain. So due to the low resistance presented by the input of each stage to the preceding stage, it will lower the gain. So the effective load resistance of each stage would be increased. The voltage and power gain could be increased. So if you have to increase the effective gain of the transistor as an amplifier, we have to increase the load resistance. So it can be achieved by transformer coupling. So by using the impedance changing properties of the transformer, the low resistance of the stage, or we can say load, can be reflected as high resistance to the previous stage. So this can be achieved by using a transformer. So what transformer will do? The transformer that has what we call as a mutual inductance concept. So the low resistance of the stage, or we can say a load, it will be reflected as the higher resistance to the previous stage. So it can be done using a transformer coupling. So transformer coupling generally employed when the load is very, very small. So this is the circuit. We can see this is a transformer coupling, where the primary is connected at RC, where in the RC coupled amplifier, we have RC resistance, collector resistance here. It is replaced by primary, and the coupling capacitor is replaced by secondary. So it will go towards the next stage. So now when AC signal, when we apply AC signal in here to the base of the first transistor through this capacitor called Cin, we'll get amplified version of the input over the primary of the transformer. The voltage developed across this primary is transferred to the secondary. This is nothing but an input to the next stage. So the second stage that renders the amplification in an exactly similar manner as like we have discussed in an RC coupled amplifier. The frequency response of the transformer coupled amplifier is like this. That's why it is not suitable in many cases, but it has some advantages. So you will see the frequency response as like the frequency is increasing, the gain is like if we talk about this particular frequency or bandwidth, the thing is good, but again for the other frequency the gain is not good. So we can say from that particular figure the frequency response is rather poor. So gain is constant for a very small range of frequencies, otherwise it is not constant at all. So the output voltage is equal to the current multiplied by reactance of the primary. So we can see the gain. So we can see at lower frequency, the as we can say XL as the primary is inductance, so 2 pi FL as the frequency is lower, but will have the overall product will be lower and it will begins to fail, we can say fall, and resulting in a decreased gain. So what about at high frequency? The capacitance turns of the windings act as a bypass condenser. So this transformer has turns, and in that the capacitance, it will act as a bypass condenser to reduce the output voltage, and hence the gain will be again decrease when we go frequency that is higher. So there will be a disappropriate amplification of the frequencies in a complete signal. If we talk about a speech or music in between 50 to 20 kilohertz, we are not seeing it at all. So the transformer coupled that will again going to introduce a distortion. Some advantage of the transformer coupled amplifier, as no signal power is lost. So we can see the power lost is there, no power loss is there in the collector or base resistors. Excellent impedance matching that can be achieved in a transformer coupled amplifier, because it is easy to make inductive reactances of primary equal to the output impedances of the transistor. So inductive reactance of the secondary equal to the input impedance of the next stage, which will make the excellent impedance matching. So due to excellent impedance matching, transformer coupling provides higher gains. As matter of fact, that if we use single stage properly designed transformer coupling, that can provide the gain of two stages of RC coupling. So two stages of RC coupling is a single stage of transformer coupling. Disadvantages: it has very poor frequency response. As we have seen, the gain varies considerably with the frequency. The coupling transformers are bulky, so it is inexpensive, or we can say it is expensive for the audio frequency but not for the other frequencies. Frequency distortion is higher, low frequency signals are less amplified as compared to the high frequency signals, and transformer coupling tends to introduce hum in the output. So there will be sound at the output of the transformer coupled amplifier. Next, third type, it is called as a direct coupled amplifier. So there are many applications in which extremely low frequency, that is less than 10 hertz signals, that can be or that should be amplified. So where it will be a direct coupled amplifier is the solution when we have very low frequency. So the previous tools were used when the frequencies becomes higher and higher, while in case of direct coupled, we'll go for the frequency which are very very lower, like an example, photoelectric current, that is in terms of like microamps, or thermocouple current in microamps. So we have to amplify it, so they are very low frequency, so we can use it to amplify it. So the coupling devices such as capacitors and transformers, that cannot be used because the electrical sizes of these components becomes very large at extremely low frequencies. So one stage is directly coupled to the next stage without any intervening coupling device. This is called as a direct coupling. You can see here a transistor 1 is here, transistor 2 is here, and it is directly coupled to this, and again it is directly coupled to this. There is no any coupling capacitor, or we can say transformer coupled is there. So this is a three stage direct coupled amplifier. It uses complementary transistors. Thus the first stage, we can see here, this is NPN transistor. The second stage is a PNP transistor, and so on. So this arrangement, we can say this is again a NPN transistor. So this arrangement makes the design very simple. We can see the three resistors and three transistors. The output of the first, that is developed across this collector resistance RC, it will be directly fed to the input of the second transistor T2, and so on. So we can have a direct coupling and we'll have output. So what is the operation? The weak signal is fed from this side to the input of the, or we can say base of the first transistor T1. Due to the transistor action, we'll have amplified version over here. So this will be fed to transistor T2. So this will drive the base of the transistor, and transistor output is obtained across T3 collector load. So we can see if this transistor becomes on, pole will be go towards this. So it will becomes a biasing of this transistor T3. And we'll have amplified version over here. So in this way, we can raise the weak input signal to the strong signal. Direct coupled amplifier we can use in very low frequencies. Advantages is that arrangement is very simple, minimum use of resistors and transistors. Circuit has low cost because absence of inexpensive, or we can say expensive, coupling devices. Disadvantages, we should know that it cannot used for the amplification purpose as like high amplifier. The operating point is shifted due to the temperature variation. So due to the temperature variation, you know, white noise or Johnson's noise available inside transistor, and as well as the resistors resistance is changes with the temperature. So operating point will be shifted, and finally we'll have what we call gain changes. So this is the most important slide of this particular lecture, that if we go for the frequency response, RC coupling is excellent. We can say transformer coupling is like a poor, and the direct coupling is the best. Only we cannot go for the gain. The cost is less because only RC is extra. It is more because of transformer we are using, and it is less because there is no RC as well. Space and weight, it requires a less space because the RCRs are nowadays, they are like surface mounting devices. It is required more space because of the transformer, and weight is also there. And it is very, very least because the RC is again absent in here. So we'll have a very least space. Impedance matching, it is not good at all. It is excellent. It is good because we are not using any kind of coupling. So the impedance is good. Where we can use the RC coupling, we can use is for the voltage amplification only. In case of power amplification, we go for transformer coupling but for the certain frequency range. And for amplifying extremely low frequency, like the signal from the sensors, we can use to amplify it. So direct coupling can be used over there. Thank you for listening my lecture. Please subscribe my channel and stay tuned for the next videos. Thank you.